Good evening, I'm Christian Esguera, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. Let's begin by dissecting the news. Recently, the interviews have given voters a glimpse of where certain candidates stand on climate and environmental issues, and where they stand in their list of priorities. Vice President Len Robredo, for instance, pushed for climate-resilient communities. Mayor Isko Moreno said he would adopt new technologies and equipment to address the impact of climate change. Senator Panfilo Lacson cited the Philippine commitments in the global effort to limit global warming, though unlike bigger countries, the Philippines, he said, isn't that big a contributor in carbon emissions. Senator Manny Pacquiao, meanwhile, promoted the basic idea of planting more trees. To be sure, what these candidates laid out were still basic ideas, perhaps for lack of time to expound on them during the interviews or the lack of sufficient understanding of the issues. Now, be part of our discussion. Send us your questions and comments on our YouTube live chat or tweet us using the hashtag ANCAfterTheFact. Joining us tonight is Mr. Rodney Galicia. He's the convener of the civil society network Action Clima Pilipinas. He's also the executive director of the group Living Laudato Si Philippines. Also with us, Greenpeace Philippines Country Director, Leia Guerrero. Good evening, and thank you for joining us tonight on the program, Rodney and Leia.
Good evening, Christian. Thank you.
Okay, very important issue. The one that we're going to talk about now, climate and environmental issues as campaign issues in the Philippine elections, in the May 2022 elections. So far, I'd like to get your thoughts regarding the pronouncement so far by certain candidates. Are you seeing a good understanding as far as certain candidates are concerned on how important these issues should be during the campaign? Leia?
In terms of yung understanding of the candidates of the issue, what we've seen in the interviews so far that has happened, parang kulang pa. There's for a lot of us in civil society who are championing climate, we don't see a climate champion yet among our presidential candidates. Maybe it's the lack of time to expound on what are their climate plans, but we'd really like to see something a lot deeper, like how would they, what is their perception of the climate crisis as among the priorities that they will be pursuing if they get into office. We don't hear where it figures in the bigger scheme of things in what their program would be. And that's just the tip, right? Because we are also not hearing deeper, more meaningful plans about how they want to address this crisis.
Okay, Rodney, what do you think? And why you think it's very important for our candidates to make their platforms known specifically on these issues?
It's the sense of urgency, Christian. The sense of urgency, and we remember Typhoon Odette. No? Typhoon Odette happened a few weeks after COP26 in Scotland, in Glasgow. But at the same time, perhaps they're still thinking of the current situation we have, COVID-19. But remember, after COVID-19, after this pandemic, we still have the climate crisis to face. No? And we hope that it's not only about the goal that you wish to achieve, like climate resilient communities, the strategies you wish to do, like technology and planting trees, but I believe it's the full understanding of the emergency, because we're in a code red right now, and we know that typhoons, the intensities of typhoons are getting higher and higher. So I believe it's a sense of urgency that the candidates really need to understand.
But did you also see that sense of urgency in previous elections, for example, in 2016 or in the 2019 midterm elections, given the fact that Typhoon Haiyan happened in 2013? So that should have given us more urgency to talk about this. Pero did you see that in subsequent elections? Or the issue of climate and the environment was basically drowned by other issues such as corruption and other brickbats among candidates?
Yes, as election would always happen, there are so many promises. One of the platforms of the Duterte administration is on the environment and climate change as well. But we all know that they could still continue opening more coal-fired power plants and even defending coal projects. And on top of that, in the cabinet, there are still officials who are into investing in not so really climate friendly industries. So I think the National Climate Change Action Plan, if the Duterte administration is very serious about the climate crisis, the National Climate Change Action Plan should have been reviewed, and it should have been revised. Many years have passed, and it has not been revised as well. And we remember the global coal commitment to stop and facing down coal. Our national government was unable actually to sign on the 2 out of 4 commitments. So I mean to say, it's not really that serious. So every election we have promised, but we need clear and distinct platform, which may lead as well to policies, mm-hmm. so that we can make them accountable.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Leia.
Yeah.
Oh, sige, sige. Before I throw my questions again.
Sorry. Yeah.
Go
I was
going
to say that I agree in past elections, the environment doesn't seem to be a top priority in government, even of candidates who are running for higher offices. It seems like it's an issue that's always parang behind, syempre, because they will say they want to address poverty. Yung nagyari noong 2016, yung platform ni Duterte is the drug war and so on. So it's always drowned out by other issues. But we think na this time we cannot afford to have environment and climate drowned out, especially for this next administration that will be in place in the Philippines. Climate will be the defining issue ng administration nila. And why? Because diba, if you look at all the reports of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, this decade from 2021 to 2030 is the crucial window for action, for climate action. And if we don't put enough action on climate, we don't mitigate enough, we don't meet yung 1.5 na limit, the worst impacts of climate are going to happen. And it will happen to the Philippines kasi we are one of the most vulnerable countries. So the candidates need to realize that climate and environment need to be front and center sa policy nila. Not only because, it's good to talk about sustainability. Siguro some of them, kasi minsan sustainability is like giving platitudes to yung to people, diba? Parang I'm green, etc. Pero we really need a candidate who understands the issue, who understands climate, who understands what needs to be done. Because yun nga, if things don't change in the next 8 years. It's going to be downhill from there.
And of course, for the one who would be elected president in May 2022, yung mananalo, no? So, problema niya yan for the next 6 years, yung epekto ng climate change, no? Kunwari, bagyo, 20 typhoons on the average, sabihin lang natin na 5 or 3 of them will be too devastating, costing millions if not billions of pesos. That would be a problem. But my next question dito, Leia dito, for instance, no? Did you also get the sense na listening to what the candidates have been saying so far about climate action, that somehow they're still limited in terms of perspective to, let's say, recovery, o kaya doing something after a disaster happened? In that case, we would be focusing on the cost.
You're absolutely right, especially in the recent interviews. I think partly maybe because the question was framed in terms of recovery also. So there's also probably a need for us to start talking as a whole, not just for our presidential candidates, pero us as society, to talk about climate crisis, not as yung what we could do after the crisis has happened, right? But what we could do now to prevent the crisis from happening. Ang problema kasi, diba, parang we remember climate only when there's a disaster. And that's quite parang limiting for us. Parang medyo may blinders tayo. Kasi, for example, sa Pilipinas, that probably is only one of the worst effects that will happen. Yung kapag if we don't stay within the threshold of 1.5, yung isa sa mga pinakamalalang consequences will be masisira lahat ng coral reefs or majority of our coral reefs will be devastated, will be destroyed. And what does that mean for fishers? Diba? A lot of our coastal communities rely on fishing. We rely on fish for our protein. So that has impact on food security. So the candidates need to realize that climate change is not about disasters. It's really, it cuts across everything. It's about food security, it's about water security, it's about energy, it's about justice. So pag na-realize nila na yun talaga yung parang yun nga yung sinabi ko kanina, defining issue, kailangan siya ma-address kasi yung benefits niya will cascade to all other issues that they are looking at, especially poverty.
Ang ganda ng pagkaka-connect ni Leah doon sa issue ng climate, doon sa food security, no? Para talagang sigurado malapit sa bituka. Rodney, we understand that to many people this is not a sexy topic, even among media practitioners, no? Parang there's a significant airtime or space in the news provided to climate issues. Pero by and large, drowned out pa rin ang ibang mga more sexy, quote-unquote. It's not a sexist comment, by the way. Parang parlance yan, di ba? Sa mga controversies. Pag hindi ganun ka-sexy, quote-unquote, yung topic, parang hindi pinag-uusapan. Pero in this case, if part of the problem has to do with the candidates, perhaps having limited knowledge about the issue itself, what should, let's say, the communities do? Let's say, to make sure that this would be discussed. That if their candidates campaign before them, they should be talking about this, food security, for example. Ano epekto sa kanila in concrete terms? Pag walang ginawa yung pamahalaan nila for the next 6 years o kung walang plano yung tumatakbo sa pagka-presidente regarding this problem?
Yeah. We need to bring down the conversation at the local level. I remember one candidate said that the communities to be affected must be included in the whole conversation. Say, for example, it's not only when we talk about food security, we also talk about how they get food and how they produce food. For example, we have the farmers, and how would the extreme weather conditions brought about by the climate crisis affect them? Extreme weather conditions would mean drought, longer droughts. And we actually experienced this. Remember what happened in Kidapawan, no? Bigas versus Bala, no? Yeah. What happened there was actually these farmers experienced a longer drought. So that's why they were unable to harvest more yields. And some others, for example, in the Cagayan province, in that region. So we have this typhoon coming, and their crops have been affected by flooding. So I think it's actually getting people and communities in for them to understand. Because I agree with Leah that naalala lang natin ang climate change kung may bagyo at pagkatapos nasira yung ating mga pananim, nasira yung ating kabayan. And we have to not really organize, but You know, Christian, at the local level, we have this local climate change action plan. The local climate change action plan, matagal na ito. And kung alam lang ng mga tao yung plano na ito, ano, because in the local climate change action plan, you have 7 strategic priority areas. Like you have food security, you have water sufficiency, and knowledge, etc., etc. And alam ba ng mga tao ang mga ito at the strategies at yung mga kaparaanan upang maka-adapt doon sa epekto ng climate crisis ay nandun. But then again, we go back to the basics. If the candidate doesn't know the basics of the climate crisis, how can she or he lead us to solutions? Does she know or does he know what adaptation means or mitigation, even climate finance? Or what is her or his definition of resiliency? So in times of crisis, a leader should shine. And the understanding of the basic problem of the climate crisis is really necessary. If we don't know the problem, understand the problem, then I think we will have false solutions.
Okay. Leah, let's go to the other aspects of the policy issues. What would you like to hear in concrete terms from our candidates for president? To be specific, doon sa mga carbon majors, sa mga big polluters, in terms of policy, what would you like to hear or to know about it?
Siguro to begin with, I'd like to know yung stand ng mga candidates. I think the Filipino people should know yung stand nila on accountability of big polluters. And this includes both countries and corporations who have been most responsible for the climate impacts, the climate emissions that we're experiencing right now. So siguro I would ask as a voter, what actions do my candidates have in mind to demand more financing from countries for payments for loss and damages? Kasi nga, di ba, yan yung pinaka, isa sa pinakamalaking problema natin kapag merong bagyo. Tapos, how will they demand climate justice? Will they support, ito parang crucial question for me, will they support climate litigation? Diba? Mm. Will we take these climate emitters to court? I think that's a very crucial question kasi we do realize, and the current administration also realizes, that this is not a problem that we could solve internally and on our own. And we need to be there in international fora and to use international platforms that we can for us to have justice.
Yeah. Okay. How about yung shift to more renewable energy? Doon ba sa portfolio natin, nasaan ba tayo? Sa renewables, 30% ba or less?
Parang mga 35 ata eh.
35. So, go ahead.
No, sorry. I was gonna say that just recently there was a move to increase it. Pero currently, in terms of yung energy transition, I think it would be good for us as voters to find out what is the candidate's position on following through with the coal moratorium. Because the current administration looks at the coal moratorium as a kind of a shining centerpiece over there, right? Pero in reality, it hasn't shut down any plans na nakalusot before the moratorium. So we still have a lot of coal in the pipeline. So parang how are they going to follow through that as a basic question? Because that's already on the table. Pero what they need to still bring to the table after the coal moratorium is how are they going to phase out fossil fuels and increase the share of RE, diba? So ano yung mga policies na isa-strengthen nila? Kasi nandun naman yung RE law natin eh. It's just a matter of how fast and what aspects of it will they strengthen.
Okay, you're referring to the moratorium on new coal coal-fired plants ng 2020. Okay. Rodney, yep. What would you like to see or hear from our candidates?
I would like to see, first and foremost, in fairness, during this Duterte administration, the concurrence of the Paris Agreement happened, the submission of the National Determined Contribution happened. I would like to see their stance on the implementation of the National Determined Contribution. Mm-hmm. Implementation means it's not only the certain government agency that would implement, should be inclusive, that the communities and even the sectors, non-government, the businesses are involved in the formulation of the implementing rules and regulations. I would also expect if a candidate would actually say that once they are elected and if they, the oath of office, they will declare a climate emergency. And with that could be a policy mandate of all. No, however, learning from this administration for almost 6 years, the Climate Change Commission has been doing its job, even the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. But I think there's a need to synergize all government agencies to actually participate seriously in the processes of the Climate Change Commission. It's quite complicated for the last 6 years, that even the Department of Energy has different track of of their national determined contribution, and Department of Environment, Natural Resources for forestry and emissions, among others. The Department of Agriculture has its own. I think there's a need to empower and strengthen government agents, specifically the Climate Change Commission. But at the same time, the climate diplomacy that you know we're praised. No, the credibility of the Philippine delegation has been really obvious in many years, but it's dwindling right now. So I think we may need to retake, to take that seat again, being one of the most vocal, and at the same time being one of the most influential when it comes to climate diplomacy.
Kasinga, we're speaking based on experience. They made the Philippines the poster boy because of the experience in Haiyan, di ba? Tapos itong audit ulit. So people should be listening to us. I think there are certain studies na we're not just among the most vulnerable countries. Parang tayo na yata in the most vulnerable country. Diba? Leia, yung ano, yung go ahead. Sige. Rodney?
Actually, I agree with you that when Yeb had this speech in one of the climate conferences, the whole climate negotiations changed because the human face has been restored, and we've been talking about climate justice almost every conference of parties. And we hope that this COP27 in Egypt, the Philippines would be able to send more competent delegates to negotiate for climate justice and to pay for climate debts, you know, make singil doon sa mga malalaki.
Okay. Leia, your group has been very passionate about this climate emergency. Let's flesh it out. No? What difference would it make? Let's say if the next president makes this among his or her priorities, yung climate emergency declaration, ano yung difference na makikita natin dito? Dapat?
For us, yung ibig sabihin ng pag-declare ng climate emergency, and our Congress has already declared it, pero it's not being followed through. But what it should create is yung sinasabi ni Rodney kanina, that sense of urgency and that parang coherent na climate action. So what we're saying is that this should spur the government into using a climate lens in policy and decision making and in implementation. So parang when they look at plans, projects, when they look at the Philippine Development Plan, the climate lens is there. Currently, wala siya. The climate lens is only used, for example, nung sinabit natin yung NDCs, diba? We're still not looking at issues from a climate perspective. And syempre, we have a bias for having this perspective kasi as a campaigning organization, we believe that climate should be top priority, and we hope that this is something that the candidates also understand. So what do we mean by them putting a climate lens? It's not just yung not just in terms of making yung the energy transition happen through policies, etc. It's also looking at how we could respond to yung mga anticipated na climate impacts na magyayari sa mga communities. So it's not just after a storm has happened, but it's looking at, for example, our agriculture sector, di ba? Parang it's been a question that's sinasagot ng maraming mga entities, maraming mga grupo. How do we make our agriculture climate secure, right? Climate smart, diba? For us, the answer is parang connected lahat ng mga parang environmental policies. So to make agriculture climate resilient, we have to look at more ecological ways of growing crops, not yung industrial agriculture, which also relies on fossil fuels, diba, as inputs. So We need to be looking at all these connectivities between yung issues not ng climate with food, water, energy, yung sinasabi ko kanina, and address it coherently. Kasi we can't, this is not the time for ano, yung one agency doing one thing and another agency doing another thing. We need talaga yung ano, parang sabay-sabay na yung kumpas para talagang ma-secure na yung future ng mga Pilipino. Ay, balikan ko lang yung sinabi ko kanina, yung sa percentage ng RE. Nagkamali ako, mga 21% yung current. Yung sinasabi kong 35, it's the ambition that the DOE has now put because of the one of the provisions of the RE law recently. The ambition is 35% RE by 2030, and we think that's still pretty low. I think we have a study na kaya ng Philippine government na 50% RE by 2030, and we should aim to decarbonize by on or before 2040.
Yeah. Okay. Before we end, I'd like to get your thoughts regarding this debate or discussion regarding the proposed establishment of a Department of Disaster Resilience. No? What do you think of this, Rodney? How crucial is this when it comes to addressing these problems that we have been talking about? Or is it more of a solution that could also be limited in scope and perhaps limited because it would only address a few portions of the entire conversation?
Christian, this is a very complicated issue. Action Klima has been very, very consistent in its position on the Department of Disaster Resilience, and even our other colleagues, no, for Disaster Network, DRRNet. For us, I think this will be a super department. If we say super department, there are provisions there that all the budget and the financing will be actually controlled by this department. And the CSOs have already expressed and articulated our concern when it comes to, if you have ayuda from other countries, you need to inform the government. Yeah. And even if the government would observe that this NGO is not capable of disbursing and using this fund, the government can actually take over. The other thing is that the disaster risk reduction management officers of the local government units will be centralized, into a new department under this department. And I think that can still be studied upon, because as of now, the frontliners are the LGUs, and these people are really, really knowledgeable about the local situation there in their community. So I believe there's a need to review it. And we've been asking also for the review of the disaster reduction and management law, a comprehensive one, and we hope that this department will not be another department that will actually put some budget to waste.
Okay, this Leia. Okay, Leia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sa akin yung take ko is, more on parang limited nga yung reach niya, diba? Kasi kung disaster lang yung i-address niya, it's not really the full spectrum of what needs to be addressed sa climate. For example, how will this, kasi yung usapin naman sa climate, it's not just about, as we said earlier, diba, yung disasters after. Ano yung, paano mag-figure dito yung transition, energy transition, diba? Which is a key component sa pag-solve ng climate crisis. Paano mag-figure dito yung how we ask for climate justice from the international community, and so on, how we ask for climate justice and accountability from fossil fuel companies. It doesn't seem to be a part of that DRR. So tingin ko, it's not really about forming another department. Ang dami na nating departments and so on. It's really rallying around one parang policy, a strong parang underlying direction ng bagong gobyerno, 'di ba? Kasi kahit naman meron tayong DRR department, kung hindi well understood ng gobyerno ang job ahead to address climate, hindi rin niya mapupull in into a coherent strategy yung ating approach to climate, 'di ba? So parang mas maganda siguro for the new administration to look at climate, look at policy making, look at implementation from a climate lens, parang gawin niyang overall policy, for example, okay. Na yun yung direction ng at vision ng gobyerno na susunod.
Okay, Ms. Leia Guerrero and Mr. Rodney Galicia, thank you for joining us tonight on the program.
Thanks very much. Yeah.
Okay, we're going to take a quick break. After the fact, we'll be right back.